He was like this moldable piece of clay.
He was highly motivated, and he was going to achieve greatness.
He said, I don't drink, I don't do drugs, I don't do anything. And we were like, whoa, designated driver.
The real man was more interesting than the character he was portraying.
His mother could not believe some of the stuff that he was doing.
It was huge. It was a huge part of, like, pop culture.
It's one of those crazy Vegas nights, and we end up married.
Mr. and Mrs. Hunter Hearst Helmsley.
A lot of people were coming to me at events. Keep your eye on him. You know, I don't trust him.
Triple H tearing his quad is one of the most gruesome things I've ever seen.
He stood up on it, which is impossible.
When you picture World Wrestling Entertainment, he's it.
It's baptism by fire, especially when the chairman is your father-in-law and his family.
To have a home life with three young daughters and a working wife, to me, is remarkable.
I mean, his toenails were painted green for 2 weeks.
I think they're gonna be looking at him the same way they still look at Michael Jordan, like he's just best there's ever been.
More importantly to me, he's a Hall of Fame human being.
In 2008, the seasoned veteran was drafted to SmackDown, where he helped cultivate lesser experienced superstars. The game's reign at the top of SmackDown proved fruitful and full of fortune. But when the lines of reality became blurred on Raw, the King of Kings was forced to climb upon his white horse and journey back to Monday nights.
Destroyed the entire McMahon family.
Oh!
I had pitched elements of that story. You know, it just made a lot of sense, right? It was the big reveal of us really being married.
It's the worst kept secret in this business. Triple H and Stephanie McMahon are actually married in real life.
While pretty much everybody knew we actually were married, it was never acknowledged, you know, on television.
There's one thing to say you're married, and then there's another thing to put that on screen and have that your persona where you have to be a regular dude and have a wife and show that emotion. And it's a weird mix of fans buying that and fans going like, ugh, like, Jesus Christ, he's got the same kind of shit I got going on in my life. It's just a weird dynamic there, putting that out on TV, but at the same point in time, it's so out there, how can you not?
I wonder what the last thing your wife remembers when I grabbed her by the neck and I slammed her pretty little face right down to the ground.
I really feel like we just had this emotionally charged angle that people were really absorbed in.
I kicked his father-in-law in the face. I beat up his brother-in-law multiple times. I had DDT'd his wife and kissed her on the lips while he was handcuffed to the ropes and couldn't do anything about it.
It had just gotten so sickeningly personal that they wanted to see us tear each other apart. And they decided to put a stipulation on the match that
if Triple H is disqualified, if he's even counted out, then he loses the WWE title.
It's one of the only times in my career where I have felt absolutely handcuffed by a situation, and both Randy and I were just like, how on earth do we do this?
Undertaker and Shawn Michaels went on before us that same night. I remember being in the training room, looking over at Hunter, watching this take place. And I mean, these guys are, you know, kicking out of tombstone pile drivers and kicking out of super kicks, kicking out every possible finish you could think of. And false finishes like that, especially between two huge established stars like HBK and The Undertaker, that's hard to top.
I remember, like, walking by Shawn and Taker, and I followed him in the locker room, and I was like, guys, I don't even have the words to tell you how awesome that was. But in my mind, thinking, the both of you. Like, we were already f***ed, and you just threw an earth full of dirt on us.
This next contest is scheduled for one fall, and it is for the WWE Championship.
Triple H needs to stay under control.
Yeah, he's got to be careful there. If he's disqualified, he loses the championship.
We had presented an angle where it should have been a war. And knock down, drag out, just blood and guts war. But we had to have it in the confines of a scientific wrestling match.
Moment of truth!
No, no!
Moment of truth! Don't do it!
The reaction we got, it was almost like that crowd, that Undertaker HBK match sucked the wind out of him. So I remember he was slightly disappointed because of that, but you know, he's a perfectionist.
God bless us, we tried, but we just could not, you know, we just couldn't overcome it.
I was happy with that night. You know, crowd reaction or not, we had told these awesome stories weekly on television. It all culminated in this, you know, huge WrestleMania match where I main evented WrestleMania with Triple H.
The angles were great, but we just never got off the starting block delivering the product. And it was, you know, listen, that's on us at the end of the day. You know, you want to play in the big leagues, that's all the shit that comes with it.
Triple H was the leading man in the WWE locker room. But 2010 delivered an exciting time for Triple H to get out of his comfort zone, to step away from the squared circle, and step onto the red carpet in his first leading role on the silver screen. But his journey there began nearly 10 years before.
Vince had come to Rock and I and said, I want you guys to meet with Endeavor, who reps the company, and try to put you guys in a couple of movies. And I remember Rock being really excited, and then Rock left, and I was like, can I talk to you for a second? Like, I'm a bit confused here. Like, you don't want me to wrestle anymore? Like, what? Like, I don't get it. And he was like, no, I just want you to think about doing some movie stuff outside. He's like, well, you don't want to do it? And I was like, well, I don't know. Like, how can I do that and do this? And he was like, well, we'll try to work it out with the schedule. Just meet with him or whatever, you know. And then I am tearing my quad shortly thereafter and going about our business. But it was the first time it had been mentioned to me, and I really didn't have a whole lot of interest in it at the time. And then a few years later, Blade came up. And it was an exciting opportunity, and it ended up, I was just supposed to be a short thing, and I ended up getting there, and they liked what I was doing, so they made my part bigger, and I was there a lot longer, and it was a lot of work at the time, but it was fun doing and all that stuff. But it still was like, you know, when I got done doing Blade, they offered me a deal with New Line, like a three-picture deal, and I turned it down. Like, I talked to Vince about it, and I was like, that's just not what I want to do, you know, and we turned it down, and for a lot of reasons. And fast forward to now, the company's got its own movie thing, and Vince is like, I'm gonna do this movie. It takes, I don't know, it's only a few weeks to shoot the movie.
Sound speeding.
Background.
That.
Action.
And cut.
Check the gate.
All right, who's ready for some field tripping?
I've always thought Triple H is a movie star, and I thought he would be terrific in this because he's able to instantly make the transition from tough guy, which he has to be in this film, to sweet, sensitive, caring father.
He has a natural style about himself. He knows how to be funny. He knows how to be warm. It's just dialing it in here and there, you know, and I think he already has a certain affinity to it.
He has an amazing capacity for feeling, and I think his dramatic ability has already been established, right? You can't do what he does in the arena without being a dramatic, theatrical, skilled person.
The movie stuff for me is fun because I still get to do a bit of what we do, the physicality.
You gotta move this way for me to hit him, boom, to be able to.
Telling that story with that physicality is what we do in the WWE. then I also get to be a different character and show different emotions and things that I wouldn't necessarily, you know, there's not a lot of room in WWE for me to find a 12-year-old girl and try to convince her that I'm an okay guy. It's a different kind of a thing, you know.
He's a really hard worker, and he just comes prepared. He made me look good several times.
I get that. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
He's got an enormous presence, not just of his size, but his confidence, his feeling that it's a privilege for him to be making a movie. His appreciation for the opportunity he's been given and that he's running with it.
Let it be, all right? Let's just get it.
He's one of the biggest, one of the best. He's a legend in the WWE world, and I've seen him do 3-minute monologues in front of 50,000 people, so I knew he would be comfortable. And he's been a pleasure to work with. He's very humble, very hardworking.
Not to embarrass myself, my Hollywood aspiration. I like to make movies where I don't look like crap, and that's pretty much it.
I'm just blown away that you haven't done this before. You did this in school.
There's a theory in life about you're in a good place when you have all the go-away money you need. I'm at that place, so I'm just having fun, you know, and whether it's WWE films, whether it's Hollywood, whether it's the WWE, whether it's any of that stuff, to me, it's entertaining our fans. And when you can go out there, no matter what the medium is, and entertain people, that's what I love to do. So whatever avenue of entertainment comes along, I'm there.
This is a picture wrap on Paul Levesque. Whoa!
6 months and 2 movies later, it was now time for the game's return to the WWE Universe and entertain like no other.